evolving, if you will. In a simple textbook can no longer fulfill the student's desire for knowledge. Is there a solution? I have one. It goes off what the founding fathers wanted for the United States, a more perfect union. Tablet computers can benefit the student in several ways. I personally say they should replace the student's textbooks. Would you allow me to explain? My first reason is that backpacks pose a serious health risk. Experts say that your backpack should be between 10 and 15% of your body weight, which for me, at 112 pounds, that's between 15 and 16 pounds. Fun fact, after 2 days of too much stress on your body due to your backpack, it can cause back, neck, and hip strain, which is surprising considering so many people complain about their poor backs these days. Did you know that a tablet filled with 4 gigabytes of data is only a billionth of a gram more than if it was completely empty? And also, in the 2011-2012 school year, 13,700 U.S. kids were put in the hospital due to backpack-related injuries. That's 13,700 too many people, if you ask me. That's 20 times the amount of kids we have here at Jefferson, which we have about 835. Teachers say that you can leave your textbook in the classroom overnight. While this may be true, what if you have a game to catch, a ride to catch? That's totally convenient for a student. My second reason is it's cost-effective. Textbooks are doubling while tablets are dropping. Yes, tablets are still a little bit more expensive, but by the time you count into the fact the 4 textbooks you need, math, science, language, social studies, that's about $400. And even when you buy the tablet and the ebooks, it can save you about $200 a year. The school board says that not all schools will be able to afford it. Yes, but have the student's parent or guardian pay for a small little fraction of it. My third and final reason is the success that tablets will bring. It can improve your standardized testing scores because of what you're learning. It makes it more fun and students get more involved with the activity. You can also take notes and highlights on the chapters you want. If you do it in your normal textbook, you can get in major fines or major trouble. And with 98% of schools now having Wi-Fi, this should not be a problem. Wi-Fi has been known to be finicky. Like when we take iStep, it crashes. That's been that way for several years. That's because too many people are on that server at the same time, and that could cause it to slow down or crash. Many students prefer it based on a survey done by Heather Molinix. One anonymous student said that he prefers the tablet over the textbook because it's easily accessible and it beats carrying around the 5-subject notebook. In conclusion, tablet computers should replace students' textbooks because you can think of the success, how cost-effective, and how the 13,700 kids would not have been put in the hospital. If tablets opened up a whole new world of opportunity, like the founding fathers wanted when they said, "We the people of the United States in order to form a more perfect union." A more perfect union. The tablets can help us achieve that goal. So if you won't give tablets a chance, you're closing a door that can't unveil you for life. And I hope you now agree that we should take backpacks off our backs and put tablets on our desks.
Single American deserves to be treated equally in the eyes of our law and the eyes of our society. These are the words of Mr. President Barack Obama. LGBT. This stands for those who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender. Equality is the quality or state of being equal. Equal means having the same rights and social status as others. According to the Washington Blade, the LGBT community does not receive the equality they deserve. 594 people were murdered in an act of hatred in the Americas during the 15-month period. This is a national tragedy. I strongly believe that the rights and equality of the LGBT community comes down to these three arguments. What causes sexual orientation and gender identity? What rights are the LGBT community denied by our government? And finally, what does Christianity and the Bible have to say about sexuality? To begin with, imagine you are a young boy with a huge heterosexual family. At the age of 12, you realize you were different. You liked the boys in your class. You tried like many others, including YouTube sensation Connor Franta, to like girls and maybe even kiss them, but it just didn't feel right. At 18, you meet another man. You love him. And because of that, you're kicked to the street by your own family. 5 years later, when you want to say I do, your government tells you that you cannot get married. Sexual orientation and gender identity was proven by the University of Texas, neuroscientist Simon LeVay, and many others to be caused by the structure of your brain, and most of the time, not by choice. Bruce Jenner recently said, "I feel like a woman inside of a man's body. This is not someone you chose to be. It was someone you were born to be. Next, what rights are the LGBT community denied by our government? According to Ranker.com, equal employment, the ability to donate blood and save lives, adoption, the right to serve in our military, and the most popular, the right to become married. Same-sex marriage is illegal in 13 states. According to the General Accounting Office, 1,138 benefits, rights, protections are only available to married couples. These include hospital visitation during an illness, the option of filing a joint tax return to reduce a tax burden. I believe that this is unfair and unjust. Some people believe that this would violate their religious beliefs. But my argument is that we have a secular or non-religious government. And according to the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. So why can't we just all accept that we're human beings? My third and final point is, what does Christianity and the Bible have to say about sexuality? In Leviticus 20, verse 13, if a man lies with another male as he does a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood is upon them. This, to most people, is why you should not be gay. But I, coming from a Christian background, have to say that we have all committed an abomination and should be put to death. And the funny thing is that Christianity preaches about sins being forgiven and loving everyone. And saying that this only applies to some people is actually going against the Bible. As in Matthew 7, verse 1. Judge not that you not be judged, for with the judgment you pronounce will be judged, and with the measure you use it will measure you. Furthermore, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than this. In conclusion, the LGBT community deserves equal human rights. This is because the science and biology of sexual orientation and gender identity, the unfair treatment towards the LGBT community due to our own government, and the evidence of Christianity supporting these people. As South African minister Nelson Mandela once said, to deny people their human rights is to challenge their very humanity. Finally, think about this for one moment. An 8-year-old boy who was gay was brutally murdered by his very own father because he did not accept who he really was. Would you be able to kill your own flesh and blood over something they could not control? Thank you.
You run like a girl. How often do we hear this phrase in movies, TV shows, and in society? It is always used as an insult, but since when is being a girl insulting? I believe that females are discriminated against in today's society. This is especially true in the workforce and in the media. Women earned approximately 78 cents to a man's dollar in 2013, according to the Institute for Women's Policy Research. If trends continue, it will take approximately 44 years for women to reach equal pay. Jobs predominantly done by women pay less on average than jobs predominantly done by men. What's equal about that? 60% of college graduates are females, earning 57% of the master's degrees, 61% of bachelor degrees, 50% of doctoral degrees, and 2/3 of all psychology doctorates, according to the Education Department. Even though women earn over half of all degrees, they are still met with this pay gap entering the job market. We have the education, why not the pay? Pregnancy discrimination is treating a woman unfavorably because of pregnancy, childbirth, or a medical condition related to pregnancy or childbirth. According to the Pregnancy Discrimination Act, it forbids discrimination on pregnancy when it comes to any aspect of hiring, firing, pay, job assignments, promotions, layoffs, firing, training, and fringe benefits such as leave and health insurance. Thousands of pregnant women are fired each year when requesting accommodations for a healthy pregnancy. This unfair treatment is caused from a gap between the pregnancy discrimination and disability laws. The Supreme Court took up a case in 2014 of a pregnant UPS employee who receiving unpaid leave when requesting lighter duty work. The Pregnancy Discrimination Act requires employers to treat pregnant women the same as other temporarily disabled employees. And UPS violated this by refusing to grant her request but granting other employees of this change. Why should a pregnant woman be treated any differently than someone coming back from an illness or surgery with restrictions? In 2012, a female executive at the Computer Sciences Corporation filed for sexual harassment from a male coworker. She was told to stop complaining and was fired a couple of days later. When will enough be enough? When will we start treating these issues with the seriousness they deserve? Some people say it is necessary for women to have this 22% wage gap in case they were to need maternity leave if they got pregnant, although women are much less likely to get injured on the job than men that would require them to take time off. So why aren't our pays equal when there is no guarantee that every single woman on earth will become pregnant, nor will every single man get injured? It is not fair for employers to stereotype women and dock their pay. One of the most common forms of female discrimination today is society's standard of the perfect woman. If females are not seen as thin as girls in magazines or on TV, they gain a poor self-image. Most companies targeting women through media try to get them to buy their product by tearing them down, then telling them that their product will make them prettier or skinnier. Why is it okay for the media to tear girls down to meet their monthly quotas? 40% of 9 and 10-year-old girls have already been on a diet. That's just under half of little girls who should be playing with Barbies are instead of worried about being overweight. And who is to blame for this, you ask? It's the very thing your lives revolve around, the media. Ladies, how many of you have ever compared yourself in a positive or negative way to another girl? According to Just Say Yes, teen girls are more afraid of gaining weight than they are of cancer, nuclear war, or losing a parent. 3 to 10% of girls in each state are anorexic. Who are these degrading images and expectations geared towards? Once again, women. Media causes negative self-image for most women, but not all. Some people think that women are taking these simple images way too far, when in truth they don't know what it feels like to be constantly compared to these other females, when it is impossible for the majority of women to achieve this standard. Females are through with inequality. This is the 21st century. Discrimination should be a thing of the past instead of the present and future. Next time you are told that you do something like a girl, don't be discouraged. You should be proud of who you are, not the punchline of a joke. Thank you. Slow, silent killer. I'm all around you. You'll never know, because your stomachs have all cried for me. Only some aren't lucky enough to escape my deadly grasp. And even if you are, I'll always be there, tormenting your mental and physical health. I kill every 10 seconds. No, you can't lock me behind bars. Yet some still suffer from me behind bars. For when I make people of all ages cry out in pain, when I kill, I don't leave a mess. I'm so deadly that you do so little to try and stop me. For I am hunger. Hunger affects children's growth and brain growth. Think about it. If you don't water a plant, does it grow to the best it can? It's the same for a child's growth and brain growth. Kwashiorkor is a protein deficiency that affects millions of children around the world. Kwashiorkor causes swelling of the stomach and flaky skin. This is just one of the many deadly diseases caused by hunger. Others are vitamin A malnutrition, tapeworms, iron deficiency, and malnutrition. America spends 15% of their gross domestic product on healthcare. Children who needed hospitalization due to hunger increased by 1/3 in 2014. Maybe if we took care of hunger, we wouldn't have to spend so much on medical care. Kids in Indiana who didn't receive the recommended amount of calcium had greater risks of bone fractures, and kids in Georgia had low levels of zinc and iron. This caused suppression through the immune system, which later caused behavioral and motor delays. Hunger affects how kids focus in school. Kids who are hungry tend to not judge risks as well. Did you know if you eat a healthy breakfast every morning, you're 20% more likely to graduate? If you don't have enough food to eat breakfast or anything, you're more likely to drop out. If kids keep dropping out simply to the fact that they don't have enough food to eat, who's going to be our next generation of doctors, lawyers, or even teachers? In Nepal, 10 to 15% of kids don't even finish primary school due to hunger, for they had to drop out and start working to help put food on their table for their families. Hunger is also linked with depression, anxiety, and suicide. 15 to 16 homes that were food insecure were 5 times more likely to attempt suicide. Also, kids suffering with hunger were twice as likely to be suspended from school. Kids 6 to 11 who lived in homes without enough food were twice as likely to have seen a psychologist, and 1.4 times more likely to have repeated a grade. 60% of adolescents living without enough food had at least one suicidal symptom, thoughts of death or a desire to die. 20% attempted suicide. Hunger is stressful for both kids and parents. This can lead to anxiety. Anxiety affects many daily things we do, such as school or work. Hunger would cost $30 billion per year to end. I know, that's a lot of money.
but we spend $718 billion per year on defense. Also, it's not like the government would have to pay all $30 billion. Walmart donated $2 billion to help end hunger worldwide. All the president would have to do is call local organizations and businesses to help out. Also, 87% of the American population said they'd be fine with us sending aid overseas, yet we still donate the smallest percent. Now, I understand how it's not our job to help other parts of the country, but isn't it our moral obligation? I mean, how many times have other countries helped us? Also, people in Sub-Saharan Africa make a dollar a day, and here we complain about making $7.25 an hour. Couldn't wealthy people and businesses grant loans? American companies will spend millions of dollars trying to create a picture-perfect image when that money could have gone to starving people around the world. Some might say we have bigger problems or hunger will never be a thing of the past. And in a way, they are right. Hunger will never go away and it will never be a thing of the past. But 805 million people, one in seven homes, are affected by hunger. Why not try to lower some of these numbers? Also, hunger is one of the world's biggest problems. Every 10 seconds, someone dies from it. Why not solve one problem, which leads into a million other problems? In conclusion, hunger has effects on people that can last a lifetime. Hunger can lead to dropping out all the way to suicide. Isn't it ironic how half the world is eating too much and dying, and the other half isn't eating enough and dying? Now, I'm not asking you to be like Walmart and donate $2 billion. But 50 cents goes a lot farther than you think. That money you just spent on those pair of shoes could have gone to feed someone who hasn't eaten in weeks. That food you just wasted could have, children are literally dying to eat that food. So just remember, when you go to bed at night with a full stomach and more than likely to wake up in the morning, someone out there isn't, because our slow silent killers killed its next victim and is working on its next billion. Thank you.
Look around. I tell you, look around at your neighbors, your friends, and your family. When you look at them, do they seem any less human than you? Homosexuals are considered unhuman to opponents of gay marriage. However, I see that as wrong. They believe that homosexuals should not have the right to marry. I think they should. Opponents of gay marriage often have a strong biblical base that says gay marriage is not right or even harmful. In my eyes, I see homosexual as a perfect part of our world. In the 10th Amendment, it says that no state should make a law that hurts people's rights or interferes with their lives. When I look at my reasons, I believe that we should follow the 14th Amendment. Another reason gay marriage should be legalized is because it does not create emotional nor physical harm to heterosexuals or heterosexuals who are in a relationship. In 1962, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. stood and said, "I believe in equality." That was for immigration. Now, why is that not the same for gay rights? More than a third of citizens believe that gay marriage should be right. They have changed their views and said, "I believe that this is right." So why can't we, as a state, agree? The Pew Research Center has shown that over 53% of Americans believe that gay marriage should be legalized. In 1978, Senate said that marriage was the most important relationship in life. If this is so, why are we arguing that this is not? Why are we saying that this is not, that this is harmful? In 1967, 16 states legalized gay marriage. There are 50 states. So I believe that gay marriage should be legalized in every single state. And let's change that 53% of people who believe into 100. If we reach that goal, adoption rates are recommended to go sky high. Every year, a child dies because they do not have a home. Every year, a child is homeless and the parents have given them up. With the gay rights laws, there will be couples who want a child they cannot produce on their own. Therefore, they will be saved. When you discriminate against marriage, you are discriminating against your peers, your family members, and your neighbors. Everyone is human, and everyone has their rights. It is love. If you decide that love is not love, who are you but any less human? I tell you to look around. Now, this is not only in the United States that this is happening, but I hope that you will see as I do. For when you are asked about gay marriage the next time, you will proudly raise your hands and say, I believe. The Pew Research Center also showed that people say it is wrong because in a biblical term, it is right that Leviticus, no man should sleep with another man. So I ask you, when you look around, will you raise your hand and say that you believe?
Execution, homicide, mutilation, termination, and murder. All of these words bring disturbing thoughts and images to our minds. However, many people witness and support these concepts every day. Our society overlooks the destruction of innocent life. They do this by turning their cheeks to abortion. But before I get into that, I want to tell you a little bit about a very inspirational character I came across. I'm sure you all know him. However, if you do not, I'm sure your kids do. His name is Horton, from Horton Hears a Who, and he went on an incredible journey to identify something that we should all already realize. But first, take the Bible for example, which never uses anything less than human terms to describe the unborn. Also, God did not tolerate murder, nor those who commit it. He was quoted as saying, "Cursed be he that taketh the reward to slay on an innocent person." Finally, God makes no mistakes. If a child is conceived, God obviously had to plan for that child. Who knows? The little boy or girl that you're killing today could have grown up to be the next Tom Brady, the next Condoleezza Rice. They could have been the president of the United States. To make changes in this world, no one could have ever imagined, or even dreamed of for that matter. According to ProCon.org, proponents identifying themselves as pro-choice contend that choosing abortion is a woman's right that shouldn't be limited by governmental or religious authority. However, what about the fetus's right? That fetus doesn't have a choice, nor a voice. Let us be that fetus's voice. Let us protect the fetus from murder. Abortion is also murder. According to federal law, murder is the act of killing an innocent human being, or person, if you will. The definition of murder is a deliberate intention, unlawfully, to take away life of a fellow creature. Keep in mind, a synonym to person is creature, and basic science has proven that a fetus is a creature. You make the connection. Around the time the 14th Amendment was created, Senator Howard was quoted as saying, "All men are equal in the rights of life and liberty before the majesty of American law." Now back to the 14th Amendment, which was created to protect classes like the unborn. However, it came around when abortion was illegal. Today, abortion is legal. So do we just forget about the 14th Amendment? Do we make an adjustment in it to support this murderous act? Half of pregnancies among Americans today are unintended, and about 2 in 5 of those ends in abortion. The number one reason for having an abortion is because the teen moms and young adults are not financially ready. They just don't have enough money to have a baby. So they go to the easiest solution, have an abortion. Abortion is easy, right? Abortion is painless, right? This is what abortion supporters would say. But I'm here to tell you right now that abortion is a huge health risk. Take Tanya Reese, for example, who was just 24 years old when she was faced with the challenges of pregnancy. She was unprepared, but most importantly, she was terrified at the thought of having a child. So she decided to have an abortion. She went to a Planned Parenthood facility located in Chicago to go through with this procedure. She came out feeling great. She had no other responsibilities. She only took care of herself. What could go wrong? I'll tell you what. Later that night, Miss Reeves died of a hemorrhage due to the abortion. Once the news of her death spread over social media, Planned Parenthood was terrified. They were apologizing left and right. They were even quoted as saying that they care about their patients. If this was true, 50% of the patients that walk into the Planned Parenthood facility located in Chicago would not have to be carried out in body bags. Keep in mind, abortion causes hemorrhages, abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, infection, and last but not least, death. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, abortion is just plain wrong. Abortion is murder, it is a sin, it is a huge health risk. Help me to stop abortion. Vote against it. Petition against it. Remember previously how I mentioned Horton, that inspirational character? Well, he went on a courageous journey to prove to the world that a person is a person, no matter how small.
Imagine your child going to school like any other day. When she comes home, you ask her how her day was, and she gives you a vague response and walks to her room, shutting her door behind her. A few hours later, you go to her room and knock on her door. When she doesn't answer, you decide to open the door. You see the most horrifying sight of your life. Your previously kind, loving daughter is now dead on the floor. You decide to open the door. You see the most horrifying sight of your life. What? No. With a razor blade in one hand and an empty bottle of pills in the other, you find a note that says, "Sorry, I can't take it anymore." This scenario is way too common. Every 40 seconds, someone dies of suicide. This is why I think it should be a crime in all 50 U.S. states to bully. My reasons for this are suicide rates go up. People act on the victims, not the bullies. And only 1/3 of the U.S. states have legislation for harassment. Most people say that bullying is just someone being mean to them. Bullying is actually a repeated action of harassment or assault that inflicts mental and or physical pain upon another individual. So my first reason I stated before is that suicide rates go up. According to the National Youth Violence Prevention Resource Center, 30% of adolescents in the U.S. are affected by bullying, whether they are the bully, have bullied before, have been bullied, or all of the above. 40% of the people bullied go through effects such as depression, drug use, emotional distress, cutting, suicide, eating disorders, and bruises from fights. Amanda Todd took a picture nude and posted it online. She was tormented in school. She left school twice and her attacks followed her. She committed suicide October 8, 2012, and people claimed that they were happy. Another student jumped off a 14-story building because bullies took all of their money away. My second reason is that people act on the victims, not the bullies. So what do schools do? Well, states with legislation have to allow students, parents, and school administrators to report all investigations for each and every bully. There must be an investigation for each and every report and a strategy to resolve the conflict and a call home. States without legislation have to talk to both the victim and the bully, and then both together. Sometimes there's a call home. My third reason is that only 1/3 of the U.S. states have legislation against harassment. According to the National Oregon Study, 1/3 pass laws such as Colorado, New Jersey, and more. One of the ways states deal with bullying is suspension. But as you know, suspension only lasts 3 to 6 days. And when the bully returns, they will see that their victim is more vulnerable and they attack more. According, the NSW Crimes Act has been in place since 2003, but it has no effect. In these states with legislation, you can charge the bully with different offenses such as threatening behavior for threats, indecent assault for sexual harassment, and criminal offense of assault for physical assault. States without laws cannot charge a bully with a criminal offense. Some say, cope with it, walk away. But the attacks follow the victims. It follows them home. Others say that mental illnesses caused by bullying is temporary, but it can cause long-term depression and suicide, which means you're dead. Forever. Some people say that if you're bullied in school, they can't do anything about it. They need proof. But if every state has laws, then they have to investigate every report. So in conclusion, I would like to say that bullying is a crime. What if you got called ugly or stupid? It hurts, trust me, I know. Bullying brings forth thoughts of worthlessness and hate. Suicide rates go up. People act on the victims, not the bullies. And only 1/3 of the U.S. states have legislation against harassment. Maybe if we had laws, then that parent wouldn't have a dead daughter. They could have seen her grow up and live her life. Thousands of people die each day because bullies decide that calling them names is fun to them. They don't stop to think about the repercussions or to see what they caused. They intentionally hurt anyone they don't like. These people obviously need to stop. And who's gonna stop them? us. Start now to stop bullying. Thank you for your time.
Imagine four kids below the age of 13. To outsiders, this family looks happy, carefree even. Behind closed doors, however, is a different story. The wife is occasionally pinched, smacked, choked, and grabbed. Now, sometimes these attacks are also taken by the youngest son. Verbal and emotional abuse isn't foreign to this family either. This family's attacker? Their father. Would you believe me if I told you this story was true? Sadly, it is, and it was what it was like growing up part of my childhood. I still remember everything like it was only yesterday. It was like waking up to your worst nightmare. Yet when I spoke up about my father's attacks, he didn't get any consequence. My story is one of the billions of domestic violence stories. Every day, over 10,000 women are abused, but in most states, domestic violence is only a misdemeanor crime. This means the offender will only receive a short jail time, small fines, or short probation periods. But this is only if the charger is arrested and charged. The offender is arrested and charged. Shouldn't the offender receive a larger penalty? I'd like you to consider the real impact domestic violence has on an individual and their family. Afterward, I hope you will join me in this fight against domestic violence. My first reason is to stand up for those whom have been emotionally and psychologically abused. This may not leave physical scars, but it still leaves scars. According to SafeHorizon.org, victims face anxiety, depression, sleep problems, and from personal experience, they also have extreme stage fright. My second reason is for the physically abused. According to the Department of Justice, 4 million women and 3 million men experience physical assault each year. Physical assault can be pointed towards intimate partners, parents, and children. Over 3 million children experience domestic violence each year. Over half of domestic violence isn't reported, states SafeHorizon.org. Domestic violence can also lead to development of heart diseases and eating disorders. But we've allowed to get domestic violence far more out of control. According to the article, Domestic Violence Can Be Cured, 42% of female homicides were done by their male partner. Children, they are the main reason why I wrote this speech. Those children are 30 to 60% likely being abused or neglected. The terror and fear abuse weighs down on children seems to stay with them forever. I remember what it felt like when your heart was racing and you just wanted to run, but you were too scared. If the offenders were given a larger penalty, maybe the victims could have the closure they needed. While others may still believe that therapy is the best way to go, can't offenders just pretend they're all better? And really, wouldn't therapy only work if you wanted it to? 28, that's about the number of women who have been abused in the past few minutes. These are the reasons we need to enforce the laws on the offenders, against the offenders of domestic violence. Domestic violence offenders should serve a longer jail time, but also take counseling to set their mind straight, if they want it, of course. Just consider, how would you feel if you witnessed a member of your family, or maybe even a total stranger, being abused? Would you feel anger, fear, or sadness? Well, I would, and I hope you will join me in this fight against domestic violence by sending these offenders where they belong, in a jail cell. Thank you.
Imagine sitting in rows organized in alphabetical order. In front of you lies a test booklet. You're the smartest kid in your class, and you've taken many tests before, but this one seems to be tugging at you. After the drill-like instructions from your teacher, you realize this is a standardized test. Everything is based on your score. Your learning ability, your intellect, your class selection, the school's rating, and the effectiveness of your teachers. I believe standardized testing should not be required in schools. The test does not take into account a student's uniqueness and learning style, is too stressful on kids, and takes too much time away from class lessons. To start, standardized testing does not take into account a student's uniqueness and learning style. There are no two kinds of anyone, so how can the exact same test be efficient for people who are all different and learn in different ways? A study from Brookings Institution in 2001 showed that 50 to 80% of students' year-over-year test score improvements were temporary and did not contribute to long-term changes in learning. Connecticut Education Association, CEA, is the largest teacher organization with 43,000 members. They want to eliminate major standardized testing with more flexible progress testing. CEA launched a two-week, $250,000 TV ad campaign to encourage support. They believe schools and teachers should not be evaluated on how students perform on high-stakes tests. CEA officials cited a poll of 500 likely Connecticut voters, and 67% agreed students take too many tests, and 84% believe too much time is being taken away from classrooms. State and federal education requires annual tests for grades 3 through 8 and one statewide test for high school. However, CEA is proposing progress testing instead to let teachers know how students are doing and what they need to work on. This would reduce emphasis on test scores and greater assess things like collaboration and communication skills and social and civic engagement. Mark Waxenberg, executive director of CEA, quotes, "We want to help our students, and the critical objective is to eliminate the unnecessary. Duplicative tests has overtaken our schools." Secondly, standardized testing puts too much pressure on kids. Pennsylvania System of School Assessment Test, PSSA, students score on performance profile. Student score must be seen as advanced or proficient for schools to be seen as successful. PSSA also has a value-added score, which evaluates teachers based on the growth of their students. That much pressure can really get to kids. One in particular, Evan Yetter is an 8-year-old at Middlesburg Elementary School in Pennsylvania. He is having trouble sleeping and anxious all the time because he's afraid of not getting ahead. If he doesn't do well, he'll be held back. He and his friends are afraid of being punished if they don't do well. Parents say that their children are upset and worried to the point of physical illness and anxiety. If children are being physically ill, don't you think that's too much stress on them? A poll from Pennsylvania residents show that 84% believe there's too much pressure being put on kids. Lastly, tests take too much time away from classrooms. Schools in Lubbock, Texas were prevented from learning about the first anniversary of the September 11th terrorist attacks because they were too busy with standardized test practice. Governor Mark Dayton also believes time is being taken away. He wants to cut tests Minnesota students take by a third and is seeking federal authority to do so. His bill will eliminate 7 of the 21 assessments students are required to take. Mark Dayton quotes, "The disproportionate amount of time and test preparations that has resulted from the federal No Child Left Behind law and additional state requirements has stifled teachers' creativity and ability to impact information to students." Dennis Batch, union president, also quotes, "Schools should inspire and engage students while teaching them critical thinking and problem solving, and all other skills that would lead to successful lives, but often doesn't happen due to the hyper-emphasis on standardized testing. We swap learning time for testing time, and deep learning for bubble filling." President Barack Obama set up a waiver system allowing states to opt out of certain requirements in exchange for creating detailed plans to improve academic performance and close achievement gaps. Minnesota, along with 44 other states, applied for a waiver. Opponents say the test will help grow education in America. However, after the No Child Left Behind law in 2001 showed that U.S. slipped from 18th place to 31st place in world math for the Program for International Student Assessment Test. Similar drops in science occurred and reading did not change. National Research Council reports found no evidence test-based incentive programs are working. In conclusion, standardized testing should not be required in schools because tests do not take into account of students' uniqueness and learning style, is too stressful on kids, and takes too much time away from classrooms. You should not judge a child's intellect by scores. We are not numbers, we are people. We don't need standardized tests to tell us if we're smart.
Second runner-up, our number three speech was written by, and unfortunately or family missed, seventh grader Nevaeh Dye. So we'll look forward to that. Our first runner-up, second place, and again, this was very, very close, and this student will speak at the to the eighth graders at the eighth grade breakfast on the last day of school, and that is Miss Gibby Schaefer. And our winner, who will be speaking at awards night on Monday night. So now this person has to write another speech for Monday night and then present on Tuesday. And that goes to Miss Haley Ross.